I'm always surprised when I recover skeletons that are highly fragmented. It's a small window into a very short moment of their death. This soldier was blasted away, got buried, and forgotten for a century. This is where you realize the force of the war. It was such a brutal, barely imaginable context. Personal artifacts are always special because you can feel how they are distorted by a blast. It's also an indication that the soldiers died at a moment where the soldiers weren't necessarily expecting to die. People don't realize that our cemeteries are alive. Thankfully, they are growing because it means we have recovered more soldiers and we've given a shot at identifying them and returning them to their descendants.
Unfortunately, not every casualty who died in the First World War was afforded a burial even on the battlefields. And that's the case with the burials that took place at New Irish Farm. A number of the remains were found in what we term a commingled situation. The burials were later destroyed or damaged by shellfire. That emphasises the complexity of our work and the care that we take to ensure that everyone who is found is afforded a dignified burial today.
When we're notified and we go out in the field, we know that the end game is a ceremony. The field excavation is really the heart of our work. We are the first step in this dynamic process of commemoration perpetuity.
We are the keepers of the graves. We are the guardians and the custodians of these great memorials. We know the cost of war.
We're absolutely committed to retaining the sort of sense of place of cemeteries and having them as beautiful places to visit. At the inception of the organization, you can imagine the battlefields were completely devastated. So creating something beautiful, that was something that certainly permeated the approach that we took. We were creating something which was that sort of model English garden. It was a notional, romantic image of something that was familiar and beautiful. We've got about 850 gardeners worldwide, so having policies and principles are really important.
We are one of the world's largest horticultural organisations. So we have to think very carefully about how we reduce any negative impact on the planet. So that looks at things like reducing the use of weed killers or chemicals, reducing the amount of water we use, increased biodiversity. So there is a big responsibility on us to be really, really sympathetic to the needs of that particular landscape and climate, and building the skills of our teams to do that. It is the most wonderful organisation, full of the most incredibly talented people. We are all a cog in a big machine, and if one cog is taken out, that machine starts to falter. So everybody matters, and everybody has an important part to play.
Our cemeteries now are being viewed as heritage and historic sites. So they are no longer just cemeteries, but they are sites with stories that needs to be told. These pillars contains close to 2,400 names of soldiers who died and whose graves are not known. Most of the soldiers died while heading to Madagascar. Others perished in the Indian Ocean when their ship was sunk by the Japanese submarine. It's quite moving to me because it makes me think about the sacrifices they made. Fighting only leads to death. I mean, these cemeteries are very important because they can bring that point home.
What the Commonwealth War Graves Commission do is really valuable. It's quite hard to capture what that importance is until you go into a cemetery and you see people reacting to what is there, even if they don't know the people that are buried there.
I work in an organisation with 1,300 staff, hundreds of contractors and 2,000 volunteers. And the common thing between all of those people is their dedication to get those stories told, to ensure that the memory of those people lives on in perpetuity.
The Imperial War Graves Commission, as it was then known, was established in May 1917 to commemorate the over 1.7 million men and women of the First and Second World War who died. It was a particularly revolutionary concept at the time, this idea of commemorating all those who died, irrespective of their rank, by name. So this idea that you would commemorate the rank and file exactly the same as the generals is hugely important. Likewise, permanently marking the graves of the dead is a significant change from previously, where quite often the dead would be left on the battlefield. So this idea of creating formal graveyards which people could visit and contemplate and reflect, but also remember the people who died was a hugely radical concept.
There really is such a wide variety of items in the archive collection. And I'm always astounded by, you know, some of the images we come across, some of the drawings we have showing some of our sites, but some of the stories as well. It's a really amazing reflection of the work the Commission has achieved. And I think just some of the items we have to tell that story are so evocative and powerful. There's just so much we can learn from the past, so many important lessons to help us for the future, which we can learn just by looking back in our archive.
You can look at the good, the bad and the ugly as well. You don't try and hide the difficult parts of history. You need to understand them, you need to talk about them. Given the significance of these two conflicts, the way in which they shaped the modern world, I think that always continually needs to be remembered. Certainly it gives you a rooting to your own identity, this concept of remembrance.
There's all of these names and there's all of these graves, and if we're not telling the stories and telling people who they are, they're going to be forgotten.
War Graves Week is all about engaging local communities and especially engaging young people within those communities and engaging those young people with the stories of those we commemorate, but also the memorials and the cemeteries which we look after within their communities. Really trying to build that understanding of the work that we do as an organisation, but also pass on the stories of the 1.7 million people we commemorate.
War Graves Week is that moment to say, look, we're a brilliant organisation who has a workforce all across the world. We have cemeteries that are looked after by experts every day of the year. Let's use this moment to kind of really celebrate who we are as an organisation. The stories tell something that the names don't necessarily always get across. What's important between especially young people and these stories is often the connection of age. And saying to a young person today, you know, 100 years ago, there's absolutely no reason why this wouldn't have been you. If you were a young man at the time, you would have been conscripted into the Army, Navy or the Air Force. What these people sacrificed during the First World War and during the Second World War ultimately has given us the freedoms that we have today. We have primary school visits where at the end you have children come up to you and say, oh, I love cemeteries now. And you can just see on the faces of a few of the children that you've changed something in their mind that day. The future of the Commission is public engagement. It's making sure that those stories live on for another 100 years.
They came, they took him, and he never returned. Whenever I talk to my mother, she asks me, have you found something about your great uncle? And we talk every day.
This mobile conflict was fought from Kenya down to Mozambique. So you needed people to carry weapons, food, and that was the carrier corps, the hands and feet of the army, and we know that large numbers of these men died.
Most of the African remains were left to revert to nature.
There was a theory that Africans were not civilized enough to be able to appreciate permanent graves.
Potentially upwards of 100,000 casualties had not been commemorated by name.
The Commonwealth War Graves Commission basically formed a committee geared towards identifying the graves that were not marked or that were left and work with their communities and see how best these people could be commemorated. Do we want to do it here, or do we want to take the bodies to a permanent cemetery and give the information about who they were, how they served?
It's about trying to rectify the mistakes of the past and ensure that all those who should be commemorated by name are commemorated.
My grandfather was the younger brother of the one who went to the war, and he talks about his father pleading with the conscriptors, saying, please, don't take Ugoya. And they said, no, he is the one that we want. When he didn't come back and years went by and nobody came back to tell him what happened, it broke him. He mourned his son to his grave.
What we are working on now is the methodology. What will be the best ways of identifying and not destroying whatever remains?
Salita is a corrupted word for slaughter. In this space, there was a military engagement. People died, some were taken and buried, some are unaccounted for, especially the Africans. And I think that needs to be investigated. What happened to this able-bodied man? Where is the body? It remains unanswered. That uncertainty is something that is not easy to deal with. I always connect that kind of pain with other families because I know thousands went through the same thing. Those cases that can have closure will also put my mind to rest. So many years have gone by, a lot of things have happened, and so it's quite a long shot, but it's worth it. The seriousness that this project is given by the Commission gives me a lot of hope. In the African context, if you bury a relative, then you put that matter to rest.
A lot of the soldiers of the Great War, for example, never spoke about what happened to them, so they didn't want to express and expose their own families to the horrors that they saw, which I think is quite understandable. We are helping people reclaim that history, if you will, their family history, and at the same time doing that remembrance.
The Commonwealth War Graves Foundation allows us to run programmes specifically for education and outreach to promote and support the work of the Commission.
We do need to be engaging people to come into our cemeteries, and we do need to be telling those almost 2 million stories of those men and women that died for all of us and for the freedoms we enjoy today.
The guiding programme shows that there are younger generations that are indeed interested in the First World War, to carry on those stories, to keep the remembrance going.
They love it. They're great. You know, they're just so engaging. They're so positive, and they're always full of energy, and they get up at the crack of dawn, and they don't mind working in the rain. You know, we are a key Commonwealth organisation, and I think as the Commonwealth evolves in the coming years, we have a part to play in that. We have to make sure that we are properly able to exercise the influence or the expertise or work in better partnerships. We've not been hugely outwardly focused before, and I think this is the chance to do that. We are guardians and custodians of the organisation today. We're building on the excellence of all those who have gone before us. It is our absolute and utter duty, not just to those people before us, but to the people we are here to look after, to remember, and to the future generations and all of those people we're trying to engage, and to ensuring that the organisation is relevant for the next 100 years. It is our absolute duty. We absolutely have to nail it.